Welcome to our lecture online. Now let's take a look at the interstellar medium within our galaxy. And often the interstellar medium is confused by the dust clouds. They're not the same. Dust clouds and bog globules are very dense regions of fairly similar material, but at much higher densities in such a way that within less than a light year of this material, these dark dust lanes of material, light is completely extinguished, meaning light doesn't go through it at all. When we talk about the interstellar medium, it's the very, very rarefied combination of gas molecules and dust particles that are everywhere between the stars. Even if you can't see it, it's there. And it does affect the light coming from stars far away. Matter of fact, it reduces the intensity of the light by a factor of 2 for every 3,000 light years. So if a star is 3,000 light years away, in between there's 3,000 light years of space, and all that dust and gas in that region will reduce the intensity of the light by a factor of 2. It only looks half as bright as it would if there was no interstellar medium. Of course, there's interstellar medium all throughout the galactic arms, and so it's everywhere, and so it does diminish the light that we see from things where we look. And that has to be taken into account. So when we take a look and we measure the brightness of an object, we have to realize how much interstellar material is in between and account for that. And of course, that's kind of difficult to do because it's like the chicken and the egg kind of thing. We don't know how bright the object is because we don't know how much interstellar material is in between. And we don't know how much interstellar material is between because we're not quite sure how bright the object is. So it's one of those things where, again, it's not that easy to make those types of measurements. But let's take a look and see what we have written down here. So the interstellar medium is simply the gas and the dust in interstellar space, not congregated into thick, dense dust clouds. So those are the dust clouds we were talking about on the previous video. Here we're simply talking about the rarefied material that's everywhere, not nearly as dense, of course, as the dense dust clouds, a very small fraction of the density. It tends to dim the light by a factor of 2 every 3,000 light years. So let's say that something is 21,000 light years away. How much has the light dimmed? So we take the number 2 and raise it to the 7th power because 21,000 is 7 times 3,000. So 2 to the 7th power is 128. So if the light has been dimmed by a factor of 128, that's roughly 6 magnitudes. That means the light we see from an object is six magnitudes dimmer than it actually is. So 21,000 light years, that's a long distance, but yet we do see things that far away, and we have to take into account that if we look through a distance of 21,000 light years, the light will have been dimmed by a factor of about 128, and therefore it has dropped in magnitude, in brightness, by about 6 magnitudes. And so we simply take 128, which is about 6 magnitudes, so that's 7 times 3,000 light years, or 21,000 light years away. Now, how do we measure and see that interstellar medium? How do we detect it? And there's three main ways in which we can do that. The first way is that we can measure the dimming effect on known luminosity objects. If we see a type 1a supernova, which of course are really rare, or better yet, how about a Cepheid variable, of which we pretty well know what the brightness is. So we measure the brightness, we then measure the periodicity, we then calculate the absolute magnitude of that, and then we compare that to what we expect to have seen. We know how far it is, we then know how bright it should be, and then we measure how bright it appears. And then we see the difference of what it should be and what it appears, and from that we can measure the interstellar medium. Secondly, we can measure the polarization effect on paramagnetic dust grains. So some of the dust grains contain certain metals in them which can be affected by magnetic fields. And so magnetic field is present all throughout the galaxy, and it then therefore causes it to take those dust grains and move them all in a particular direction. When light then shines through those dust grains which are aligned in a particular direction, we see a polarization effect. We can measure that, and then from that measure the amount of dust that's within that region. And finally, we can measure the 21 centimeter spin flip of the electron in neutral hydrogen. Of course, the electron has to be in orbit around the hydrogen, and then it can spin flip, and then emanating that 21 centimeter photons that we can measure in the semi-radio, semi-microwave radiation. Finally, the large-scale structure and motion of the galaxy can then ultimately be measured by measuring the interstellar medium. So the effect of the interstellar medium is such that we can actually see the structure and the motion at the large scale of the variable, of the galaxy, it's what we're trying to figure out. We're trying to figure out the galaxy, and so we have to figure out the structure of the galaxy beyond all those dark dust lanes that we can't see through. But if we then measure that interstellar medium with infrared telescopes and with measuring the radiation coming through those dust clouds, from that interstellar medium, we're able to figure out how things are moving, how things are changing, how things are actually structured on the far edges of the galaxy, on the other side of the galaxy that we normally can't see in visible light. So it turns out that the interstellar medium seems kind of blasé. In other words, who really cares, except it is the key to us understanding the structure and the motion in our own galaxy in areas that we normally can't see with visible light. So it is actually a very important part of astronomy in our galaxy that we need to understand so we can then find the secrets of the galaxy beyond the regions that we can't see. And that is how it's done.
So is it the same constant everywhere, the dust?
So is the dust the same density and constant everywhere? And it turns out, no, it's not. It varies from region. So what we're talking about here is a typical density and a typical degradation of the light, but it changes. That's another part that makes it so difficult. We can't be sure that it's the same everywhere. We have to assume that there's variations, although perhaps not as large a variation, but it makes it more difficult to really count on how bright should things be based upon not knowing if it changes 5, 10, 15,000 light years away. It's not an easy problem to solve.
And these are also in molecular form, the dust?
Is the dust in molecular form? And typically it is. When we talk about dust particles, we talk not about gas molecules. We actually talk about a conglomerate of little pieces of atoms joined together into small little particles. Those particles, even though we call them small, relative to atoms, they're huge, right? They could contain thousands, millions, billions of atoms joined together into little particles that are called dust particles, and dust, so they're quite large.
But they're not going to say if a spaceship hits it, it'll be
alive. If a spaceship hits it, it's like hitting a fly with a race car. Well, it could be a big fly. No, it wouldn't even be that effective. It's, yeah, basically you wouldn't see it. Yeah, the effect on spaceships would be very, very, very minimal. It might slow it down over thousands of years of period, but yeah, it wouldn't be a big deal.
So